Well, welcome home, church. Oh, that sounds good. It is good to have people back in the room, and we are so blessed to be together to celebrate this Maundy Thursday. Maundy is that word that comes from the same Latin word that mandate comes from. And so tonight we celebrate the mandate that our Lord gave us. He said, "A new commandment I give to you, that you should love one another." And that's what we get to do today. We get to just love on and care for one another. Well, I would invite you all to stand as we begin our time of worship. We begin our worship tonight in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, be in this place. Fill our hearts and our lives with your presence. Lord, do not allow us to leave here unchanged, but use this time to shape us, to mold us into who you want us to be. Lord, we pray all of this in your mighty and precious name. Amen. You know, Scripture says that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, our God is faithful and just to forgive us, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so today we have an opportunity to go before our God and to ask him to make us new, to ask him to make us more like him. And so I would invite you just to pray silently with me, and we pray, Almighty God, we know that you are good and you call us to be your voices in this world, but we stay silent. Lord, we know that you call us to be your hands and feet in this world, but we keep our hands hidden and we go our own way. Lord, we know that you've called us to speak your truth to those who are doubting, and though we know that, we end up saying nothing. Lord, we know that we're called to meet with those who need your touch, and we don't reach out our hands, and so we call upon you, Almighty God, to forgive us, to make us new. Almighty God, forgive us for all of our sins, the ones that the things we've done, the things we left undone. Make us new. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. Well, Almighty God in his mercy has sent his son to die for you. It's for his sake that he forgives you all of your sins. So as a called and ordained servant of Christ, I am just here to remind you, to announce to you that your sins are forgiven. They're washed away. You are new. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hear this reading from the Gospel of Mark, the 14th chapter. On the first day of unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lambs, his disciples, Jesus' disciples, said to him, "Where will you have us go to prepare for you to eat the Passover?" And he sent two of his disciples, and he said to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him there. And wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my children, with my disciples?' And he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready there, prepare for us." And the disciples set out and went into the city and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. And when it was evening, he came to the 12. And as they were reclining at the table and eating, Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." And they began to be sorrowful and say to him one after another, "Is it I?" And he said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born." And as they were eating, he took bread, and after a blessing, he broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, "This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." This is the word of the Lord. You all may be seated.
We continue to be thankful for the ways you all invest in the ministry here of St. Paul's and what God is doing through this place. If you'd like to continue to support that financially, you can drop that in the white offering box out in our fellowship area. Those of you joining us online can click the give link. You can always text 779 or SPL Decatur to 77977. We are thankful for the ways that you partner with us and with what God is doing in and through this ministry. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for this time tonight to celebrate. To celebrate what you have done for us, what you offer to us again and again, and what you call us to as your children. We thank you, Lord. We pray this in your mighty and powerful name. Amen. Well, we usually think of Holy Week and the events of Holy Week in this time, except for maybe Palm Sunday, as kind of a somber time. A reflective time, a time to remember the great weight that Jesus felt and the sacrifice that he made. But here tonight is a celebration. Yes, it's a celebration because here tonight we have 11 of our young people receiving communion for the first time. And that's an amazing thing to celebrate, that they might experience God's grace and forgiveness in this new way. But tonight's also a celebration of freedom. Now, when we think of a celebration of freedom, we here in the United States probably think of the 4th of July. And maybe in some ways for the people, the Jewish people of Jesus' time, Passover in a way is kind of like that. It's their celebration of freedom. If you remember back in the Old Testament, right? God's people, the people of Israel, were in slavery in Egypt. They were there for 400 years working as slaves. And finally, one day, God sent Moses, and through him, he worked these mighty acts. And finally, he brought his people out of slavery to freedom. And this meal that they enjoyed, this festival that they kicked off on that Thursday evening, Jesus and his disciples in that upper room, it was a celebration of that event, of what God had done for his people, the salvation he had won for them, the freedom he had given to them as they remembered the pain and the tears of their ancestors in slavery and of God's great act of salvation. But I could guess also that on that night, Jesus' disciples were probably celebrating not just the freedom that God had won for them, this freedom in the past, but a freedom that they hoped that Jesus was bringing here and now into the present. Especially after the events of that Palm Sunday, or as he rode in victorious, almost like a king. I could imagine the expectations they had that Jesus was about to do something big. You see, the freedom they hoped for, well, it was freedom from Rome. For though God's people now dwelled in the land that God had given them, in the land of Israel, they were not free as a nation. They were not totally free to live as God's people as they desired. They were ruled by Rome. So maybe his disciples, they were longing, hoping that here soon Jesus would be bringing freedom from Rome, political freedom. Or maybe with some of Jesus' actions, they were hoping that he was going to bring freedom from the tyranny of the religious establishment at that time, from the Pharisees and religious leaders who had made the things of God not about God, but about their own control and rule. You see, usually when we look at freedom, when we think about freedom, we really have freedom, look at freedom in two different ways. Freedom from and freedom for. Jesus' disciples were looking for freedom from Rome or freedom from the religious establishment and freedom for them to live as they wanted to, as they saw they needed to as God's people. Maybe for you and me, it's freedom from restrictions. Freedom from people telling you what to do, what you can or can't do, whether that be the government or your employer or your neighbor or whoever it might be. That we want freedom for us is to be able to do whatever we want. Maybe not just freedom from restrictions and rules, but freedom from others. Freedom to live as I want. I think of Pastor Bill the other week when he shared his story about how when Carly was off in St. Louis, he was free to do whatever he wanted, and how many of us could relate to that. Or maybe in our day and age, it's more and more people are seeking freedom from God. Freedom from seeming like there's this all-overseeing power and creator who calls them into something, who holds them accountable, who has a truth that we are all to live by. But ultimately, no matter what your freedom from is, for most of us, when we naturally think about freedom, our freedom for is really freedom for me. Freedom for me. freedom for me to live life my way, for my desires, for my benefit. Freedom is when I get things my way. Freedom from and freedom for. But really, this idea of freedom when I'm making life be my way and how I want it and by my desires, I'm really making myself God in that reality. That when I get to call the shots and I get to be the one that says how life goes, well, then I am my own God. And here into the midst of this evening, as Jesus invites his disciples into, honestly, some strange things, he brings them to these new realities of what he's doing, that he's taking what was old and bringing new meaning to them, to it. He invites them, he declares to them, God is bringing about a different and greater freedom for you. A freedom greater than freedom from these other things and freedom for you. The freedom that you truly need, even though it may not be the freedom that you naturally desire. He flips the freedom that we think we need on its head and he says, no, the true freedom that you need is freedom from you. Freedom from me. That you and I, we need freedom from ourselves. I need freedom from my decisions, freedom from my actions, freedom from my words, from my selfish and self-serving actions, freedom from my pride and desire for control, from my sin and wanton rebellion against God. I need freedom from me and my sinful self. No, it wasn't the freedom that they wanted, but it was the freedom they desperately needed. And it's not the freedom that you and I want, but it is the freedom that we desperately need, that God would bring freedom from us. Ephesians chapter 2, we hear, and you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all, that's every one of us, we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and we were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. You see, living in a freedom that's for me, living by my ways according to my desires, well, it leads to death. And here in the upper room, Jesus points his disciples to this greater freedom that he was going to bring about less than 24 hours later. That as he hung there on the cross, as he suffered, he would bring about a freedom. He would break the hold of sin on you and me and free us from ourselves that we might live for him. Isaiah 53 says, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was pierced for you and for me, that he might save you and me from ourselves. The piercing and the pain, it was all so that we might be freed from our sin and its grip on us. But it wasn't just freedom from, but it was freedom for. that being freed from our sin and its grip on us, that we might be freed for God and for others, that we might be freed to seek after God and to seek to live as his beloved child and to show his love to those that he placed before us. This new freedom is what Jesus was showing his disciples all throughout that evening. And he kicks it off by taking off his outer cloak and tying a towel around himself. And he goes around to each of his disciples and he washes their feet. And Peter, not understanding this freedom, he even argues with Jesus and says, "Lord, you shouldn't even wash my feet. This isn't right. You shouldn't be serving me in this way." But Jesus tells him, "Peter, I must wash you." And at the end of it all, he comes and he tells them, "Do you understand what I've done for you? This is to show you how you are to live. How you are to live in the freedom that I am going to win and pay and buy for you with my very life, that you might serve one another as I, your Lord and Master, have served you." Galatians chapter 5, 13. "For you were called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, for your own selfish desires, but through love serve one another." In 1 Peter chapter 2, "Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants, followers of God." Here in this holy gathering, in this holy moment in the upper room, Jesus declares loudly, "This is freedom we're celebrating. This is true freedom. Freedom from yourself and your sin, and freedom for you to live for God and for others." John chapter 10 says it, "No one took his life from him, but he laid it down freely of his own accord." And this is what we're about to do here tonight, to celebrate this new and glorious freedom that Jesus brought about for you and for me. That as we partake of this simple bread and wine that by the power of God and his word is Jesus present with us, pouring out his forgiveness and love anew, we celebrate together this freedom that God has brought for us. Freedom from that sin. Freedom to live for him. This is a feast of victory as we come to celebrate our King and our Lord and receive this precious gift from him. So friends, come. Let us celebrate. Let us rejoice. This amazing new reality, this true freedom that our God has won for us, and he invites us into once again. Amen.
This evening, as Pastor Mark mentioned, we have an opportunity to not just celebrate the Lord's Supper, but to celebrate some sixth graders that have taken a step of faith. We have an opportunity to just encourage and support. Here at St. Paul's, our sixth graders go through a training process that teaches them all about the Lord's Supper. And so tonight, they're going to be receiving that for the first time. And if after service you get a chance to go up and you know, air high five one of them, I think that'd be an okay thing, just to encourage and support them. Well, friends, hear these words that on the night on which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup. When he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." This evening, as we celebrate the Lord's Supper, you will be dismissed by Rose, and you will walk and receive the bread at the corners of this thrust here. And I would invite you to go ahead and take that even as you receive that. And then you can walk over and one of our pastors will be there to hand you the wine. In the past couple months, what we've been doing is individual blessing, but we're not going to do that tonight. And instead, once you receive communion, you will return back to your seat, and we will do one blessing at the end of communion. Friends, welcome to the Lord's table.
I
Friends, may this true body and true blood of our Savior Jesus, may it strengthen you and preserve you and keep you steadfast in the one true faith. May it bring you joy and patience as you go and live this life in him. Amen. I would invite you to stand as Kristen comes up and leads us in prayer.
Throughout Lent, we have been praying as a family of God on Wednesday nights, and we're going to be doing the same thing tonight. There will be prompts on the screen, so you can either use this time to pray with your families or use this time to pray alone and with the family of God around you. Since it's a special night for our sixth graders, I encourage the parents of our sixth graders to use this time to also just pray a blessing over them, to lay a hand on them, give them an extra little hug, and everyone else in the room, it would be awesome if you could say a prayer for our sixth graders as well as they take this next step in their faith journey. So we'll be praying out loud and in our hearts together, and then I'll close us with the Lord's Prayer. Let's pray. Jesus, you are all that we need and more. We thank you for being here tonight. We thank you for what you're doing and what you're working in the hearts of our sixth graders. And I just ask that you continue to bless each and every one of us as we pray the prayer that you've taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Well, the joy and the celebration of the upper room would eventually give way to the darkness and heaviness of the Garden of Gethsemane. A reading from John chapter 18. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons.
All who feel the
needed. After the Last Supper, less than 24 hours remained in the earthly life of our Lord. Events moved rapidly: prayer in Gethsemane, betrayal by Judas, arrest, mock trial, a painful beating, the trudge of Golgotha and execution. And as his life was stripped from him, so we strip our altar of the signs of life to symbolize his purposeful, redemptive suffering and death for us. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life and will never walk in darkness." The events of Golgotha snuffed out the human life, the light of the world. And as creation was dark when he suffered, so we have extinguished our candles and removed them. Jesus offered body and his shed blood. And he's given them to us in, with, and under the form of bread and wine in this holy mystery. As he was removed from us in the grave, so we remove the elements and the vessels of this sacrament. Our altar is in the form of a table. It's here where our Lord Jesus serves us as both host and meal at his banquet feast. The coverings and the paraments are made of fine linen, materials appropriate for feasting with our King. And as our King's body was stripped in crucifixion, so our altar is stripped of its coverings. this Christ candle remains to signify the hope of the resurrection. It will stay here except for a momentary removal during tomorrow's Good Friday evening service. Thank you for being here to worship with us this evening. Go in peace and serve our Lord.